My name is Aaron Rosenzweig. I live in Wesley, where you want to install 3 30-foot tall cell towers on our front lawns. I'm not asking you, I'm telling you to put an immediate 6-month moratorium on all cell tower deployments in the city, thus buying us time to correct our ordinances. The new language will make it extremely difficult to install cell towers in neighborhoods. It will explicitly state that when it does happen, the towers must be made to look exactly like the Bradford pear tree, the most common tree planted in our rights of way, genetically engineered by the University of Maryland. The language will also say that providers will change the color of the artificial leaves to match the seasons. Most importantly, it will read, an application for a wireless communication facility exception shall be granted if and only if the following criteria are met. 1. The exception is consistent with the purpose of the development standard for which exception is sought. 2. Based on visual analysis, the design minimizes the visual impacts to residential zones through mitigating measures, including but not limited to building heights, bulk, color, and landscaping. 3. The applicant demonstrates the following. A. A significant gap in coverage, capacity, or technologies of the service network exists, such that users are regularly unable to connect to the service network, or are regularly unable to maintain a connection, or unable to achieve reliable wireless coverage within a building. B. The gap can only be filled through an exception to one or more of the standards in this chapter. And C. The exception is narrowly tailored to fill the service gap such that the wireless communication facility conforms to this chapter's standards to the greatest extent possible. 4. Exceptions in residential zones. For a new tower proposed to be located in a residential zone or within 200 feet of a residential zone, unless the proposal qualifies as a preferred location on city-owned or operated property, the applicant must also demonstrate that the manner in which it proposes to fill the significant gap in coverage, capacity, or technology of the service network is the least intrusive on the values that this chapter seeks to protect. 200 feet is a reflection of our city's historical values. Our predecessors clearly stated that no reasonable person could be offended by the sound of a rooster from 200 feet away. Do you expect us to believe cell towers can't transmit further than a 4-pound animal? It's laughable. There are 207 homes in Wesley. Against all odds, we stand up to say, cockle-doodle-doo. You, the city council, represent 60,000 citizens, yet you far too easily bend over as if to say, any cock will do.
Next speaker, please.
Mr. Mayor, since we have a different audience today, maybe it might be worth discussing what Aaron just mentioned, because it is going to be an issue for not just that community.
I don't think
that's appropriate at this time.
Yeah. Please, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Isaac Root. I live on...
Public hearing... We have two public hearings about the budgets. This first one is about the constant yield tax and proposed property tax increase for the city of Gaithersburg for FY 2017, and don't be confused by the wording there. Stephanie, please take it away. We have Deputy City Manager Dennis Enslinger as well.
Thank you. The state of Maryland calculates the constant yield tax rate as the tax rate that would provide the same level of revenue in dollars as the previous year, but bases it on the new assessed values. So based on that, the assessed values increased 2% this past year, and so the constant yield tax rate would be calculated at 0.2568 per 100 of assessed value. The FY17 proposed budget includes a proposed tax rate of 0.262 per 100 of assessed value. This is the same tax rate that the city has had in place since fiscal year 11, so it's the same rate itself. Because the proposed tax rate is higher than the constant yield tax rate, the state does require that we hold a public hearing in order to gather public comment, as well as inform the public of that information. This public hearing was noticed on March 31st, and staff requests that we hold the public hearing, leave the record open through May 11th, and inform the public that the proposed tax rate would be scheduled for consideration on June 6th.
Thank you. Great. Do we have any questions from the dais? Not hearing any? Okay. Well, this is a public hearing. This is the time when the mayor and council would like to hear from anyone from the public who would like to speak on this topic. Do we have anyone who would like to speak on this topic? Not seeing any. Okay.
Thank you very much. Let's see. So we need, okay, we need a motion on the record remain. So staff recommends the record remain open until 5 p.m. on Wednesday, May 11, 2016. What is the pleasure of the council?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That carries 5-0. Thank you very much. And
that was really good, Stephanie.
Well done. That was definitely our quickest item tonight.
Just your way.
Please, go ahead with our next public hearing.
Actually, there are a number of things in your packet. I won't detail all of them out. We will primarily be speaking from the PowerPoint and running through that with a budget summary. As I just mentioned during the constant yield tax presentation, this year's budget tax rate remains the same. The city's general fund budget, then, which is the main operating fund for the city, has a proposed budget of $66.5 million. We've done something a little bit different with the stormwater fund this year and how that has been presented. The revenue for that that's generated by the fees is being shown directly within the stormwater fund. In the past, that was shown within the general fund, and then it was also shown as a transfer out of the general fund. And that change was really just made to for accounting regulations. Then this year's budget continues to be aligned with all the strategic directions and the strategic plan. Approximately 16% of this year's budget is being supported through reappropriations or reserves. And those reappropriations or reserves are really funds that, you know, are on hand that were a result of prior year's revenues exceeding expenditures. And these reserves are what allow the city to remain debt-free as we save for future capital projects. And so this year's reserve allocation is funding certain projects such as the police department, relocation, development of new park, as well as some other construction projects. This is a summary of the FY17 budget. Primarily, it's made up of our operating budget. The substantial portion of that really is a salary and benefits, which make up approximately 52% of the total budget. Another 20% of our budget is typically spent on other operating type expenditures. The other 20% is CIP, and then the remaining 8 are some of the smaller items shown there. I will just point out a new transfer that we have this year for the asset replacement fund, and that's something that it was previously budgeted within the operating departments. Within their budgets, the funding that we were setting aside for future year's replacement, this year we're breaking that into a separate fund so that we can show both the funding that's being set aside as well as the purchases that will be made out of those funds. As we mentioned before, the stormwater fees are being shown a little bit differently this year. So when you compare year over year, we do see a decrease from the FY16 budget. If you exclude that, the change in presentation, we did have an increase of about $2.6 million from the FY16 budget. And some of that relates to the expenditure trends shown there. Primarily, we have increased the number of positions identified there. And I just want to note that between 2009 and 2015, we saw a growth of staffing of only about 4%. Meanwhile, we saw population growth of over 12% during that same time frame. So the additional positions really are needed in order to try and help keep up with these service demands. The FY17 budget also includes additional funding for increases in health insurance, other post-employment benefits, and subsidy to stormwater management fund, which was just under $1 million. I think I went the wrong way on the slide there. There we go. On the revenue side, that increases a similar amount to the expenditures, and some of the more significant revenue changes included the increase in real estate property taxes due to property value appreciation. Some increase in funding from the state of Maryland, which we're very grateful for. We're seeing some changes related to our police aid, which was increased, as well as a one-time grant for some capital projects. As previously mentioned, we are supporting our operating budget through the use of reserves, and some of which handles the CIP, and then we're also subsidizing our main operating budget. Next, I will turn it over to Deputy City Manager to highlight the strategic plan, CIP, and stormwater.
Mayor and Council,
and members of the public who are listening. One of the things that we really try to do is tie the budget to the strategic directions that the mayor and council work on in a work session retreat. As you can see on the slide, they're actually divided into 11 different strategic elements, and each of those within that plan have key strategies along with objectives, action items, and also critical measures. I'm going to briefly go over some of the main topics for each of these strategic direction areas. So for city administration, really kind of the new issues that we're looking at is revamping the procurement policy. We actually just revised the procurement policy with council, and we're actually looking at trying to update the manual with that. In addition, as Stephanie pointed out, one of the things we're trying to do too is look at our asset management and track those assets a little bit differently than we have in the past. And as usual, we try to make sure that we're funding the trust, which helps provide the health care for the retirees at an adequate level. In terms of communication, as we move through the new era of the 21st century, as we've heard a lot today with social media and other things, we are trying to develop a major media management plan and conduct citywide training. In addition, some of the other aspects that we look at being a multicultural city is trying to make sure that our website can automatically do the translation to our website pages. And then also, we're also trying to integrate digital technology with signage, and that will be occurring in 2017. Community services is focused on trying to look at some issues on some of their main programs, which are Financial Wealth Coalition, the Bank on Gaithersburg, and look at some of the statistical outcomes. And those are actually also reflected in the critical measures for that service. In addition, we're also trying to look at expanding the vocational and career development for programs for the Wells Robertson and the DeSellum House residents. Economic development. A couple of weeks ago or last month, we actually looked at the design for Old Town Park Plaza, so that will be beginning construction hopefully in FY17. In addition, we're also trying to pursue some redevelopment issues either through the Toolbox Program and also 315 East Diamond. One of the things that we've talked with Council about before too is trying to find better ways to help the community find locations within the community and different aspects of our community. And so we're trying to look at the wayfinding signage programs for those commercial sectors. Environment, we'll continue to work with the Maryland Department of Environment. We will actually be hopefully getting our permit for our NPDES permit this year, or in FY17. We're also looking at trying to expand some of the programs that we have with regard to outreach, especially with recycling of glass, but also composting or leave it on your lawn program. Housing, one of the big issues that we'll be bringing forward to you in FY17 that's tied to the budget, and there's some money set aside for a housing study, is to look at how to use the Housing Initiatives Fund and make priorities based upon council and decisions. In addition, there are HUD requirements that we have to comply with this year, which is the development of a language access plan. Infrastructure and facilities, as noted earlier, probably one of the biggest things that we have going, particularly for FY17, is trying to complete the design for the new police station. We'll also be doing renovations to City Hall. Most of those are going to be unseen. So, for instance, replacing the roof. Then also there's also the miniature golf complex is having some minor renovations. The other thing we're going to be working on is completion of the CPSC park site. In the future coming months, we'll actually be presenting a plan that's kind of a bubble diagram of how we see that park being used. That's being developed now by the ad hoc committee. Should this occur, the acquisition of the Crown Farm buildings, we'll start to work on securing those buildings and also preserving some of those buildings to the site. That's really dependent upon the property owner, the developer of the Crown development, turning those over to the city. And then one of the other major things that we have that is often talked about is the replacement of the water slides at the water park. It's getting time that we actually have to do pretty extensive maintenance on those, and it's scheduled for replacement in FY17. Parks, Recreation, and Culture. One of the big topics they've been working on is updating the master plan, and then also trying to help with the user experience in terms of selecting off-site ticket vendor for the Arts Barn. That's not something that we offer now. They actually just go through the phone call or through our website, and it's very difficult for them to do. I mean, I think we've all purchased tickets where it's a lot easier. You know where your seats are. You know what the fee is and all of that. The other aspect we'll be doing in terms of software is selecting and procuring the new recreational management software. That is coming to an end based upon what the current provider is offering in terms of maintenance, and so we'll have to upgrade that. There are two other minor issues that are listed here on the slide also. Planning and development, this seems to be the year, FY17 seems to be the year for updating master plans. We will be completing the update for the Historic Preservation Master Plan. We're also looking at trying to increase outreach and conduct citizen and stakeholder aspects to looking at the CD zone and present those options to the mayor and council. A high priority of the council and the strategic plan is also looking at mass transit, and that is looking specifically on the bus rapid transit along 355. The police department, some of the things that they have going on in addition to working with the facility staff and public works staff on designing the retrofit for the new police station is also trying to provide more training to the officers in de-escalation, and then also really looking at the issues that we have with body-worn cameras and coming back to the council with recommendations on their future use. We're actually doing a test of those currently. Last but not least is transportation. Some of the items that council has already addressed and we're working on is development of a new pathway and pavement management systems that will help us kind of prioritize the street repairs that we need to make within the city. Along with that, we're also trying to update the road code. And then some of the actual construction projects that we'll be doing is resurfacing of a portion of Victory Farm, as described here, and then some new lighting projects. As I mentioned before, a number of these projects that we've talked about in the capital plan and the stormwater plan are actually listed in the strategic plan. Some of the ones we currently have underway are renovation of the Casey Community Center, which is revamping the kitchen there, and also some of the rental space that they have to make it more user-friendly. Another big issue is the construction of a new salt barn at the Public Works facility. That's actually tied to our NPDES permit. We need to contain the salt in a better manner to meet federal regulations. The smokehouse renovation is another item that we're currently completing. And as we discussed a couple months ago, Forest Oaks Cemetery landscaping improvements is another kind of 355 corridor beautification project. And as I mentioned before, preliminary design phase for the CPSC park site. Upcoming projects, again, most of these I've mentioned before, so I won't read through all of them. You know, we have the police station, Old Town Park Plaza. One of the ones I haven't mentioned yet is really some construction of on-street parking areas near Quince Orchard Park or Metamine Park. And then the other two I've kind of already mentioned. So. Stormwater Management Fund, we've done a little bit better job at trying to project what the out years will look like for this particular fund. Again, as Stephanie noted, this is only the second year that we've actually implemented this separate fund, and it supports a number of things. One of them is a portion of the operational expenses to support the program, which includes some staff time, but not all staff time. Grant programs and capital projects, so those we actually offer our nonprofits within the community some type of grants to help install stormwater facilities to help reduce their fees, and then also capital projects that will ultimately work towards resolution of our Chesapeake Bay stormwater, and this is always a mouthful, total maximum daily load improvements. The revenue is provided by a number of sources in the stormwater fund. As Stephanie noted, some of these actually appear as transfers, and some actually go directly into the fund. So the first one, the stormwater management fee, actually goes into the fund, and that's roughly just under $4 million. Then we have a general fund contribution for the TDMLs that I mentioned earlier. That's roughly about $1 million. Again, we're trying to get up to the point. We're just over $1 million. This is to supplement the amount of money that we believe we need for construction of these TMDLs. Then there's also the stormwater fee for city properties. This shows up as a transfer. Again, we pay stormwater fees just like every other property within the city based upon the impervious coverage of our properties that we own, including the parks and city hall and the police station. Hardship reimbursement is another portion of the revenue provided that helps some property owners who meet the requirements for hardship. And then interest, hopefully that will meet that projection depending on what the interest rates do. And so the total revenue for FY 17 is approximately $5 million. And then you'll note the anticipated expenditures for FY 17 are actually less than that. Part of that has to do with these projects take a long time for us to design, at least 2 years before we implement. But also it comes from the fact that Gaithersburg is a pay-as-you-go. So we got to actually save up for a number of these projects. Some of these projects will cost us in the tune of $5 million to $10 million to actually implement.
Can I ask a question while Sure. we're ongoing here? What happens if some of the organizations that we are planning to charge stormwater fees to, like some other governmental organizations, don't actually pay? Does that increase our bill, or what do we end up doing?
As you know, with the TMDL capital improvements that we have to make, that's driving most of the budget for the stormwater. Those will not decrease because an entity doesn't pay us. We will still have the same responsibilities. So we'll actually have to come back to you should, you know, we're having discussions with the county now, the school district, and the state regarding those properties. If they don't pay, the fee has to be made up some way. So we'll actually have to go back and run the rate model and tell you what the fee might have to be or what supplemental the council may have in order to make the fee model work over the long term.
I even want them to pay.
Well, I was hoping there was some magic answer, but I assume this is exactly what you just described.
I only wish there was a magic answer, and we are trying to work with them to pay their fair share, but that is a process that we're in running through.
Okay.
In terms of next step, I was trying to run through that fairly quickly, given the lateness of the hour. The next steps are the public is invited to provide comment, and they can do that through a number of ways. One is by email at the email address listed on the screen, also by phone. They can also mail in their comments. In terms of the next steps in the review of the budget, there'll be a work session that's scheduled for Monday, April 25th, with Tuesday, April 26th, if we actually need it. That is the opportunity where each of the departments go through their budget and kind of give you the overview of what the major increases were or the decreases were and how they're proposing to spend their allocations. And then the final actual adoption of the budget will be on Monday, June 6th.
Okay, thank you very much. Any questions or comments before we invite the public? Not seeing any. Does anyone from the public, would anyone from the public like to speak on this topic? I'm looking at the one member of the public, I'm not seeing a response. So thank you very much. As Dennis described, staff recommends that the record remain open until 5 p.m. on Wednesday, May 11, 2016. What is the pleasure of the council?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It carries unanimously. Thank you very much.